say somewhere down past this line of a billion cars is Spring Ranch, a ghost town in Clay County, Nebraska. And they, along with the surrounding region, are celebrating the 150th anniversary of the Oregon Trail. As far as the rest of it, I guess we're going to find out when we get there what they're doing.
Wife of Richard Shirley, Andrew Gibson, resident of Spring Ranch and farmer. William Taylor, son of Elizabeth Taylor and the deceased James Taylor. Sheriff R. Nixon, resident of Spring Ranch and outstanding peace officer. Sheriff, please keep those boys under control. Due to the emotional issues involved, to remind you, this is to be a peaceful discussion and that no show of force or violence will be tolerated. Sheriff, please. We will not allow any foul language or slander of names. That's understood? We will begin. Judge Burnett, welcome to our peace meeting. Can you tell us a little bit of...
Permission?
Judge, what sort of cases have you handled with those present?
Well, just you name it. Sitting right here, we've got wife beaters, drunkards, brawlers, we've got arsonists, thieves, and murderers, we've got rapists, adulterers, and you've got a whole bunch of just plain liars.
Judge Burnett, you of all people should realize that we are trying to keep this proceeding free of bias.
That's it. When you ain't gonna sell nothing with this bunch by just plain talking. To my way of thinking, we'll all be lucky if we get out of here alive.
Judge, perhaps you could share with us some of the specifics of these cases you have handled.
For the most part, the cases dealt with money. Didn't make any effort to pay him back. That is, until Liz started getting everything in right. Yeah, that woman learned the hard way that a handshake don't mean nothing nowadays.
The Hastings Lumber Company, we got a bill run up. We owed them $764. Well, they took us to court and... we lost the case. Good old Sheriff Nixon here was ordered to come and confiscate some of our property in that amount. Well, he took that much. Plus, he took a couple of mules, some sows, 12 pigs, a wagon, and a full set of harness.
It was an honest mistake.
No mistake, nothing. You was going to keep that stuff for yourself.
What happened?
Well, I took him to court, I did. I won it, too.
He sure did. I had no choice but to order him. Take all that stuff back.
Sheriff Nixon, would you return the property?
Took it right back. After all, I'm a law-abiding citizen.
Law-abiding, my boy. You took that stuff and you meant to keep
it. Well, it was really an honest mistake.
You know, what baffles me is why did you make sure that no one was around when you brought that stuff back? And while just threw the harness in the mud, he did let the stock run loose. Well, next thing I know, old Grease over there is a knocking at my back door saying that my stock is in his cornfield.
He just kept getting weaker and weaker. He was tired, he couldn't even do any hard work. Why? Right. He's been dying, he's been
eating and eating all the time, and just couldn't see
him. Yeah, and he couldn't seem to keep enough water in the house. He'd be a drinking, but just couldn't get enough.
He had to take on more of his farm work. Why, you had to tend the cattle and do all the farm.
Well, I didn't want to. I mean, sometimes James was so tired that he couldn't even go to town. He couldn't go to court if he had a case. I didn't want to, but I had to take over. Someone had to do it. James just couldn't do it. Not one of these men sitting here ever offered to help me. Not one, even though most of them owners. They just sit and call me names when I go by. Tease my boys. Now, I'll admit, Will here, he's a little on the rough side, but John, he's a good, fine boy, nice and gentle, studied so hard in school. Heck, he wanted to go on.
I'm having a little rush
here. How exactly did James die?
I lost my husband in 8 months second.
Wait a minute.
Help you out any?
My neighbors? Look at my neighbors. What neighbors?
2 months after the funeral.
That's a ball of water.
You was there. First Ma was all giggly and excited. Then she wised up. Saw you were after land more than you were after her.
Hey, I never asked that witch to marry me.
Witch!
Hey, what I'd like to know is what happened to Fidelia. You know, your wife, what happened to her?
Well, she just up and left.
Up and left without telling a soul.
She was a city girl. She didn't like the farm life much. Nor the responsibility inherited from my brothers and sisters.
My guess is she's still on your farm. Should I say under it?
Oh, you can't prove no such thing. Besides, you should talk. Can you explain what happened to all them hired hands that just vanished? How's come they never claimed that a pile of mail at the post office, huh? And can you explain in human bones in your pig yard?
As for the hired hands, they just up and left for better jobs. Well, they couldn't read, none of them, so they didn't have much use for their mail. And as far as those bones in the pig yard go, Reese, you're the only one to ever claim that you saw it.
That's right. No, the hands were always treated real well. They had a nice, warm place to sleep, plenty to eat. Ma gave all the tobacco they wanted, too.
Yeah, I've heard they got some special benefits from
this. You don't know what you're talking about. You shut up, Reese!
Yeah. He ain't worth it.
Shoot me like you did, Robert.
I didn't shoot nobody!
Huh? Ain't that you, boy? You're always protecting your mom.
Yeah, she's got a couple weeks to go. After that, you get proof I had a witness this time. Cut those tearing, tearing boys from Parrot Taylor. This time we found them, gagged them, tied them up, delivered them right in the front door of Taylor's home.
Who was this witness, Mr. Llewellyn?
Reese!
Did your boys tear down that fence?
You bet we did! He deserved the two for what he did to Ma.
That's right. Should have heard the name they called her that night.
Why, she just lost the two most important people in her life and she was trying to make the farm work. Then those idiots come over and stole our timber!
They stole your timber?
That's right. Well, they just rode by and called me names on their way to my timber stand.
What happened?
Along about January 9th or 10th, those guys just come right past our house on the way out to our stand.
That's right. We told them to get off the property, but they just kept going faster.
And then what happened?
Well, I'll tell you then what happened. You got to have a roadmap, FEMA, to tell you who's when and who's on. That was my timber. If I hadn't, those guys out there filling the wagon up.
Next yeah, and then those Taylor boys rode up a-yelling. They had a hired hand with them, too. The horse was shied. Byer, he fell off the wagon, landed on his head. And Roberts, he did what he could to control his team.
Poor Byer. Done. But he recalled that he heard a shot when the Taylor wagon passed. By all that time, we had the wagon across the field, my timber running out of hell.
Reese, who was this witness?
Well, it was my brother, Isaac. Later, me and some of the neighbors, we saw the Roberts wagon come over the hill with no driver. So we stopped the horses, climbed on the wagon. There's poor old Roberts laying atop the bottom. Half his face and head was blowed off.
Reese sent Isaac after me. I jailed these two boys right away. They've been there ever since.
Reese says Roberts' head was badly injured?
You couldn't hardly tell who he was. That way, he aimed to kill.
I may not be much of an expert on gunshot wounds, but this doesn't seem quite right. Now, Sheriff, how close would someone have to be with a shotgun to blow someone's head off?
I didn't say he blew it off. Just part of it was gone.
Yes, yes, bad enough. But how close would you have to be with a shotgun to do that?
That will's a crack shot.
Could a person riding in one moving wagon shoot a person in another moving wagon and do that kind of damage?
I suppose that he was mad enough.
Sheriff, you seem to be evading my question. Doc, did you examine the body?
I did not. They had him boxed up and buried before I could get a look at him.
In your opinion, how close would you have to be to a person to blow their head off?
Hey, we didn't say his head was blown off.
Doc, how close would someone have to be in two speeding wagons to blow someone's head off?
Oh, no more than 3 or 4 feet.
Is it possible to get that close?
Well, I suppose it's possible, but it's not likely.
Doc, please. You're saying it's not likely that William Taylor shot Edwin Roberts under the conditions described.
Ma'am, I have to live here the rest of my life.
Hey, look, Isaac saw Will with the gun.
Didn't you also tell me that Isaac was crippled and the butt of many of the Taylor boys' jokes?
Yes, Willie over there beat up on him every chance he got.
Beat up on you too, man.
Perhaps Isaac finally saw the way to get even with the Taylor boys.
Hey, Isaac ain't no liar.
Brought these boys from jail, right directly from jail today. If they're not guilty, they should live.
Seems a lot of people were mad at Elizabeth. Maybe even mad enough to take away the two most important people in her life, her two sons. She burned your barn?
Maybe she didn't. Maybe she did. Maybe she didn't actually light the barn fire to burn it. She had her hired hand to do it. And went plumb to the ground.
Don Llewellyn, why was you in jail a couple of months ago?
Jail?
Yeah, you know the place with the bars.
Jail?
Where's Sheriff's wife? Sheriff Nixon's wife, Pat, cooks for you.
No way.
Judge, why did you sentence Llewellyn to 60 days?
I can't remember.
Well, Sheriff, why did you arrest Llewellyn? Twice, in fact.
I seem to have forgotten.
Llewellyn was in jail because he was burning down buildings and out pastures. That's why he was in jail.
That's a darn lie!
Almost lost you with the delirium tremens while you was in there.
I was praying!
Started beating your wife the day you got out. I know, I had to stitch up her head after he beat her.
Doc, are you telling me that Mr. Llewellyn has been in jail for arson?
That he has.
And Mr. Llewellyn, yet you claim that Elizabeth burned down your barn.
She sure did. If she did, she had a hard hand to do it for her.
I'm completely confused as to who did what to who.
Well, it's about time I had a chance to say something around here.
I got the facts about that good-for-nothing, high and mighty, child-raping Jones sticking that grin at me.
Mr. Gibson, do you have something you'd like to share with us?
I sure do. That grin SOB. He raped my daughter. She is a mere baby for 15 years.
He raped your daughter?
Her and half the women in the county.
It wasn't always rape.
Thought he was something special, he did. Figure he had the right to do whatever he wanted to whatever woman he wanted.
Mr. Gibson, could I visit with your daughter a little bit?
What for? I can tell you everything you need to know.
Be that as it may, Mr. Gibson, I'd like to visit with Clara.
All right, girl. Now, I drug you all the way down here. You tell this woman exactly what you told me.
Yes, Paul.
Clara, may I sit next to you? I'd like to ask you a few questions. Could you please tell me your name and where you reside? Clara, please. What is your full name and where do you reside? I'm sorry, Clara, but we can't hear you. Can you please speak up?
Speak up, girl. I'll take a switch to you.
Clay County, Nebraska. I'm Clara Matilda Gibson. I'm 23 years of age.
Clara, I understand that you claim to have been raped by Tom Jones. When did this happen?
On the last of February, 1877.
Were there any other times that he had relations with you?
On the 17th day of March, 1877.
Were there any other times that he had relations with you?
At no other times.
Under what circumstances were connected with this union between you and Tom Jones?
I couldn't get away from him. I had to give in.
Was it by mutual agreement?
It was not.
Where did this union take place?
At home.
Who was present other than yourself and the accused?
No one.
If it was not mutual consent, what did Tom Jones do to make you comply?
I couldn't get away from him.
What did he do so that you could not get away?
He held me down so as I couldn't get away.
Did he make any proposals to you to have sexual relations with him?
He asked me to. His words were...
Clara, please whisper them to me. Oh, my Lord, Jones, you son of a... Clara, was this the first time? Were there any other times that he tried to have relations with you?
No.
What did you do about this, Mr. Gibson?
Well, I took a strap to her and beat the living tar out of her. I figured she could run faster with her dress up than he could with his pants down.
Mr. Gibson, she's a tiny girl. How could she defend herself against someone the size of Jones?
Then she comes up pregnant. His bastard child.
Clara got pregnant from this union?
Fat as a sow. Couldn't do a lick of work around the place. Took sick right away.
Clara, that's awful. What happened next?
I'll tell you what happened. I took Jones to court, I did.
There was no proof that Jones was the father. I was forced to let him off.
No proof? Well, the bastard child was born on December 17th, 1877.
She had the baby?
Yeah, I was so sick and tired of her being sick, I was ready to be done with the whole thing so she could do some work. She was just screaming and tearing on and, well, I seen for hours. So I sent a hand to go fetch the doc.
Well, I was hurting bad and bleeding.
You should have thought of that 9 months before. Now shut up!
Daddy, I was hurting bad!
Shut up, I said! She was screaming and bleeding even worse before Doc got there.
Doc, what happened?
Perhaps if they would have come and got me sooner, I might have been able to do more. When I got there, Claire Matilda was lying there, passed out in a pool of blood. I feared I was too late to do much good there.
What do you mean?
Well, when I was there, when she finally came to, she couldn't remember much, not even her own name. She was completely crippled on the left side also.
Clara was paralyzed?
Yep. No use of anything on her left side. You see, I believe it was due to the excessive hemorrhage episode and the amniotic fluid entering into the circulatory system, traveling to the cerebellum, which caused an obstruction, and this led to the cerebrovascular accident. She had a stroke!
Bet it out right the first time.
I'll say she ain't much good. This girl's millstone around my neck. She can't make her bed or fix my supper.
Sir, your daughter is severely disabled.
Nobody knows that better than me. I come home from working 16 hours in the field for nothing. She can't fix my food. She can't wash my clothes. She can't even draw water from the pump. Make it all worse, sometimes she makes a mess. I gotta clean that up too. It's all on account of that swine Jones.
But the courts found Tom Jones not guilty of paternity.
Well, I showed him. I took him to court because I'd lost the use of my servant. I won that one, I did. Had to pay me $5,000.
You mean that Tom Jones was found innocent of paternity, but the court found him guilty of loss of your daughter, your servant?
That's right.
I don't understand the logic. Was there more proof for this second case?
No more proof and no more witnesses. Seems like the judge was just in a bad mood.
had a case of piles or something.
There'd have been more witnesses if Jones' little girlfriend here would run off right before the trial.
Is he referring to you, Mrs. Shirley?
I guess he is, but call me Amy. If it's a sport, just then shiver, not
my back. Mrs. Shirley, you were subpoenaed to appear at the second trial?
Yes, I was.
Did you appear?
I was called away on a sudden emergency.
So sudden, her husband didn't even know where she was.
Why were you called away? What did you know about this second case?
Mommy and I were very close, if you know what I mean.
Heck, she was close to half the men in the county. Why, she's the only thing that Reese and Jones ever had in common.
So you told Jones you wouldn't testify?
No, I told him I would.
Why?
Then I left town. Well, I'm a happily married woman. What would my husband think of us while I've been with another man all day?
Especially a man like him.
I left town and didn't tell nobody. Last thing in the world I wanted was to have that Taylor and Jones punched out of me. Although that John sure is getting handsome.
Elizabeth, you
want to treat everyone fairly. Please.
Yeah, I can see this ain't leading us to nowhere. She burnt my bower down to the palm ground, and she done it, and I can't forgive her for it.
And that Tom,
please,
he made my life a living hell with a crippled daughter.
Nowhere with this.
I'll damn well ever forget that.
Where are they going?
Please, everyone.
Hey, they killed him. They killed him. They stole him. I don't care what they said.
Gather round, good people. There's a story here to tell about a place called Spring Ranch. Along this old wagon trail, a place to trade your furs and goods, a place to rest a spell. Why, a man could even buy him a stamp and send his letter there. It was back in March of 85. A winter cold wind wailed. Elizabeth Taylor and Tom Jones were judged and sent to hell. No court, no trial, no proof of wrong, no charge to even bail. Torn from sleep, bound and tied, hung from the road bridge rail. Now the would-be judge and the crazed lynch mob were sworn to never tell of the night two people died, the night two bodies fell. Now no one knows a true account of what went on that night. Were they right? Were they wrong? Were their actions justified? What of this woman Taylor? What of this man Jones? All that's left, all that remains, are the names carved in stone along this Oregon Trail Road.
And the side over here closest to my side where I'm at, we need to have you completely out of that area, totally, because there will be horses. People to the south side, move back as far as you can because we have wagons and stuff coming through there. The last performance, we had one wagon kind of get away from us a little bit. We don't need to have an accident. So please help us out. It really makes it a lot safer for everybody. Thank you.
Coming up here before the tongue come loose on the tree.
Minus five. Yeah, well, ours goes just as far the other way.
Oh, really?
Fairfield, Edgar, Glenville, and Louise. And it's all.